Arab movement was it was because Czech Republic and former Czechoslovakia should understand it's in your history too. The Prague Spring was crushed by Soviet tanks, but the spirit of that spring never died. It came to haunt a disintegrating Soviet Union, a disintegrating system, resulting in the Velvet Revolution and the end of authoritarian communism in your part of Europe. Today, we have something similar. The European Union, of course, is not the Soviet Union. We don't have gulags. Thankfully, we still don't have secret police dragging people out of their homes in the middle of the night. But there are similarities, I'm afraid. The European Union is an economy, which just like the Soviet economy, it is no longer sustainable. And at the very same time, even though we don't have a one-party state, it is as if we do. Come to think of it, listen to anything that comes out of Brussels, of the European Commission, for instance. Anything that comes out of the European Central Bank, which I know is not your central bank in the Czech Republic, but it does influence your own central bank's behavior and your own economy intimately. Anything that comes from the ministers of finance that meet in the context of the ECOFIN meetings, the European Union summit, all the way down to the government in Prague, the government in Germany, the government in Portugal, their narrative on what is happening is remarkably identical. From the president of the European Commission all the way down to the apparatchiks even in local government, you get the same story. It is as if you have a one-party state. Now, through many struggles, and the Prague Spring was one of those struggles, we managed to create democratic processes and institutions in our countries. I lived in a Greece, I grew up in a Greece that was a fascist dictatorship. When I was growing up, there was a dictatorial regime in Prague and there was a dictatorial regime in Athens. One was pro-Soviet, the other was pro-American. But nevertheless, we lived in dictatorships. Our peoples struggled for the right to democratic process. And to a very large extent, we succeeded. We have a functioning democratic system here in Greece. You have a functioning democratic system in the Czech Republic. It's not perfect by any stretch of the imagination. But something sinister has happened in the meantime. Most of the important decisions, the decisions that determine our lives in the Czech Republic, in France, in Germany, in Greece, have been transferred from the democratic processes of our countries to Brussels. Centralization. It comes with the territory of having a union, European Union. But what, however, is absolutely unnecessary, sinister, and in the end detrimental to our lives collectively as Europeans and individually as Czechs, as Greeks, as French, is the fact that we transferred this decision-making to a center, Brussels, let's say, which is a democracy-free zone. You know, some people say that the European Union suffers from a deficit of democracy. It's not true. It's like saying that an astronaut in space takes his or her helmet off and they are suffering an oxygen deficit. They don't suffer a deficit. They die because there is no oxygen. This is exactly the same situation in the European Union. There is no democracy. Indeed, the European Union was created to be democracy free. You see, it's one thing to say that there's an accident. You walk out on the street and somebody runs you over, or you're in a car and you have an accident. Nobody intended that. Accidents happen. It's bad that they do. We should take care so that we minimize accidents, but nevertheless, it was an accident. The democracy lack in places like Brussels was designed there. Now, why was it designed? If you look at the history of the European Union, the way it was created, it emerged in 1950. It was an American design primarily, but let's not get into this. But the way it was constructed, it was like a cartel. Now, you have heard of OPEC, the Organization of Petroleum Exporting Countries. These are a number of countries that export oil that together in the 1960s put together this cartel. The purpose of the cartel was to do what? To coordinate the production of oil amongst OPEC countries, to reduce production in order to increase price and to stabilize it, and therefore maintain a profit margin for each one of these countries and producers. This is how Europe was created, the European Union, not Europe, the European Union. It was created, the first name of it was the Economic Communities of Coal and Steel. It was a cartel of heavy industry. And back then, the heavy industry of Central Europe was, of course, coal and steel. After that, they brought in car making, electronics, as well as banks. And it operated for the purposes of maintaining a stable, rather high price for these products, and preventing the German capitalists from competing with the French capitalists, or undermining the French capitalists, and the French capitalists from competing with the Italian ones. It was effectively a cartel of big business, centering upon France, the Netherlands, Belgium, Northern Italy, Germany. That was it. That's how the European Union began. And the bureaucracy in Brussels was the bureaucracy for running a cartel. Now, the reason why I'm saying that is because many people, most of us, wonder, why is Europe disintegrating at the moment? Why can't we, as Europeans, do what the Americans did? The Americans, every time they had a financial crisis in the 19th century or later, in 1909, in 1929, even in 2008, they managed to create institutions that brought them closer together. America consolidated. The political process, even though it was highly dysfunctional, think of Donald Trump today, or indeed the Civil War in the 19th century. Nevertheless, the political system in the United States, every time they have a crisis, they manage to get closer together and to consolidate. In Europe, we had one major crisis in 2008, 2009, 2010, and now the whole thing is collapsing. I don't know why that is. And the answer I have, I'm proposing to you, is because of the way the European Union was constructed. It was constructed not as a government, not as a political mechanism for mediating between different classes, social classes and groups and interests, but it was created as a cartel of big business. And that cartel was well suited for distributing the profits during the good times. But no cartel is good, is efficient in distributing losses during bad times. So we are facing a very simple situation. We have a European Union that was never designed to sustain an economic crisis like that which started in 2008, 2009, 2010. Up until then, to have balanced and kept in equilibrium with... can you still hear me? Because I'm getting a message that you can't. You can you? Yes, you can. Good. So the up until 2008, 2009, the Americans, the American economy played a very important stabilizing role, stabilizing the European Union. After 2008, the American economy was so badly injured by that crisis that it could no longer provide that stabilization effect on Europe and on Asia. This is why we have a perpetual global crisis, but I don't want to get into that. What I want to concentrate on is on Europe and our crisis here, which is due to this architecture of the European Union, which is simply not up to the task of handling and managing this global economic crisis. Now, we've seen this before. This is not the first time. 1929, we had the collapse of Wall Street, And Europe's monetary and economic capitalist system could not manage the crisis that resulted. 2008 was our generation's 1929, and we have exactly the same situation. The euro and the monetary system in which the Czech Republic, to a very large extent, is embedded as a result of the foreign direct investment, primarily by German companies, into the Czech Republic. This system is now fragmenting, just like the European economic system, European capitalism, was in the early 1930s. Remember, what was it that brought to power fascists and Nazis back then? One word: deflation. Not inflation, deflation. Inflation is bad. Inflation happens when prices are escalating very quickly and wages cannot keep up with increasing prices and people's purchasing power diminishes and so on. This is a bad set of circumstances. But it is deflation that gives rise to misanthropy, bigotry, xenophobia, racism, and Nazism. Because when prices come down and interest rates become negative, it is the middle class that feels that their savings are disappearing. That, you know, business people, something that they sell, let's say this is this pen, something that today they are selling for 10, tomorrow they will be selling it for 8, the day after tomorrow for 7, the day after that for 5. While at the same time, their own savings in the banks are shrinking as a result of negative interest rates, of having to pay money for the banks to hold their money. It is that set of deflationary forces which in the past unleashed xenophobia, anti-Semitism back then, hatred of the Slavs, of the other, the Southern Europeans, the ones that have slightly darker skin, whatever. And it is the same deflationary process today which has spawned this new disintegration of Europe, economic crisis, and rise of what we call at the end the nationalist international. So, yeah, whenever there's such a crisis, whenever a building starts trembling due to an earthquake, a part of the system, the flimsiest, most fragile part, is the one that breaks down first. In the case of the 1920s and then the 1930s, two countries were the ones that caved in first financially. One was Britain, interestingly, and the other was Greece. We had a fascist dictatorship in 1936. France, Holland, of disintegration. Today, we have exactly the same situation. The crisis of the euro system first emerged in Greece, then it moved to Ireland, then it went to Spain, to Portugal. Now, it has hit Italy. Italy is not sustainable in this European monetary system that we have. And the repercussions in terms of the politics, the sinister politics that are coming up, are everywhere to be seen. We have a wave of illiberalism, of xenophobia, of scapegoating that is running. You understand that very well because, as I know, unfortunately, it is happening in Poland, in Hungary, in the Czech Republic, in Slovakia, in Lithuania, in the Baltic states. It is all the rage in that part of the world, but not just that part of the world. Le Pen in France is riding high. We have the same sinister developments everywhere. So what do we do? That is the question. Some of us, last February 2016, got together at the Volksbühne Theater in Berlin, and decided that the answer to the question, what should we do, is a democracy in Europe movement. We call it DiEM25. It started as an idea, as a response to the crashing of the Greek Spring. And it's interesting, isn't it? I didn't come up with the term the Greek Spring or the Athens Spring. Do you know who came up with that term? It was the Slovak finance minister, Mr. Kažin, who used it in exactly the opposite way to the way we are using it. When he came out of a Eurogroup in which he was asked the question, but you know, why did the Eurogroup, the Troika of lenders, have to be so harsh on Greece? His answer, a remarkable answer, and very honest answer was, we had to crash the Greek Spring to teach the others a lesson. So we took this idea of the Athens Spring, the Greek Spring, and we decided that it was too important to waste. That the Greek Spring, which was crashed, just like the Prague Spring was crashed by the Soviet tanks, the Greek Spring was crashed by the banks of the European Central Bank, closed our banks down in order to blackmail our people and our government into submission. Our people was not perturbed. They did not succumb. They voted with a magnificent 62% to say to them, do your worst, we don't care. But unfortunately, the prime minister that I was serving under in our first series of government caved in. But nevertheless, even though we were crushed, we were defeated, like the Prague Spring. Just like the Prague Spring's spirit survived and then haunted the Soviets, we want to make sure that, that what happened in Greece, that Greek Spring, becomes a democratic Europe, a democratic Europe, a democratic movement which spreads throughout Europe and answers the basic question, what should we do? There is a nationalist international, as I was saying, that is springing up everywhere. We need to counter this with a progressive international, a pan-European international, an international made up of progressives, whether they are Marxist, liberal, even progressive conservatives, Greens, feminists, anarcho-syndicalists, it does not matter. We are of a generation that must not repeat the mistake of our predecessors, of our ancestors, I should say, back in the 1930s. Remember, Democrats throughout Europe in 1930 failed spectacularly to reach out across borders, national division lines, and across even ideological division lines, and hold hands and form a pan-European broad coalition of Democrats against the Nazis, against the international of nationalists that was emerging back then. DiEM25 intends not to allow this mistake to be repeated. This is precisely what we're doing. We're coming from all over Europe. We do not come to it as Czechs, as Greeks, as Germans, as British, as Portuguese. We come as Democrats. And we're here determined, for humanity's sake, for humanism's sake, to pay any price, to bear any burden, to oppose any enemy of humanism in Europe. We're here to defend the French ideals of liberty, fraternity, and equality, but add to them the Czech, Greek, Portuguese, and so on notions and ideals of hope, rationality, diversity, tolerance, and of course, democracy. And in presenting this united front throughout Europe, we are countering Project Fear, Project Hatred, with a different project, a European progressive agenda, a progressive agenda for Europe, which understands one very simple idea, that just like climate change is not a problem with the Czechs or the Greeks, or the French, but it is a problem of human beings that want to live on this planet in a way that is sustainable. Similarly, democracy cannot survive in one country if it is trampled upon in its neighbors, in the rest of Europe. No nation can hope to live well and in dignity when other nations are being coerced, suppressed, and crushed. To understand that Europe, like an ecology, either will succeed everywhere or it will succeed nowhere. to understand, and that's how I finish, that the only way to save Europe, the only way to be pro-European is to be patriotic. The only way of being patriotic is to be pro-European. But to be pro-European means confronting the deep establishment, the deep state of the European Union, because it is they and their silly policies that are disintegrating the European Union, that they are trampling upon democracy, and therefore they are the greatest helpers of the nationalists and the bigots who are trying to split us apart. Thank you. I think I've spoken long enough.
Okay, thank you, Boris. Dennis, thank you. Okay, so now questions and contributions from the floor, otázky a příspěvky od vás, prosím. A pokud můžete, položte ty otázky anglicky, a protože by se nám špatně dvojitě překládalo. Tak tamhle byla první. So first question.
You have talked about basically two fronts to fight, and this is extremely challenging task. Can you comment on that?
It is a very challenging task, but if we don't understand that the establishment in the European Union, you know, the deep state of the European Union, and the nationalist international, the nationalists, are not really enemies of one another. It is a great mistake to think that, take Britain for instance, let's move away from Greece and the Czech Republic. Take Britain for instance, right? The status quo, the establishment, remain for Britain to stay in the European Union. David Cameron, the former Prime Minister, is an example. George Osborne, his finance minister, is an example. Yeah? And they were going on about how, you know, Britain has to stay in the European Union, that the European Union was excellent for the banking system in Britain. And then they were scaremongering that if Britain votes to leave the European Union, all sorts of horrible things would happen, and Armageddon and the collapse of the world and so on. So that was the establishment view. Yeah? And then there was the opposition of that, the Brexiteers. People like Nigel Farage, the UKIP people, the United Kingdom Independence Party, the xenophobes, the racists, who were saying, oh, these foreigners, we don't want them here. You know, they're all these Czech people and Slovaks and Greeks and Portuguese, they're coming to Britain and they're destroying our culture. We want to keep them away. And now, it very much looks like these are opponents, but they're not, really. And let me explain why I don't think they are opponents. Well, firstly, look at the actual human beings involved. Now, I have it on good authority that David Cameron, the Prime Minister, who ran in favor of Remain, deep down, he was in favor of Brexit. And it was for reasons of expediency, of strategy, that he chose to go with Remain, because he felt that he did not want to confront the City of London, who wanted to stay in the European Union. Boris Johnson, who was his great opponent and leader of the Brexit camp, the Leave camp, if you remember, he was in favor of staying in the European Union. And the only reason why he campaigned in favor of Brexit, you know what it was? It was because he wanted David Cameron's job as Prime Minister. And because David Cameron declared in favor of Remain, Johnson said, well, I'll go with the other side. So it's amazing how they can swap from one side to the other. Amazing. Think of Theresa May. Theresa May is the current Prime Minister of Britain. Yeah? She was Home Secretary, Minister of the Interior, as we would say on the continent, under David Cameron. She campaigned against Brexit, for Britain to stay in the European Union. The day Brexit won, she comes out as a Brexiteer. And now, she's campaigning as Prime Minister in favor of a hard Brexit. So you see that, you know, if these people can go from one side to the other side so easily, they really are not opponents. What is happening is this. The establishment, which is creating through silly policies and dictatorial practices. It's what I call inept authoritarianism, the inept authoritarianism of the establishment. Yeah? They are creating the circumstances for the fragmentation of Europe because their policies are destroying Europe. And because they're doing this, the nationalists are springing up from the destruction that the establishment is creating as the opponents of the establishment. But they get all their strength from what the establishment is doing. So Marine Le Pen in France, the AfD, the Alternative für Deutschland in Germany. Why are they getting strong? It's only because the establishment is messing things up so badly and because they are so authoritarian. So Marine Le Pen can run now in the presidential election championing democracy, championing reason, rationality, because those in authority are so authoritarian and so irrational that they allow for the nationalists to sound reasonably reasonable. But the moment the establishment stops doing silly things, then the nationalists fade. And the moment the nationalists fade, the establishment loses its capacity to frag good people. The nationalists do not come. But the point I'm making is you have a real but fake opposition between the nationalists and the establishment. It is real because they are clashing. You can see that in the United States, Donald Trump versus Hillary Clinton. Same idea. There was a real clash there. It was not a fake clash. But at the same time, it is a fake clash. And you can see that Donald Trump is getting elected. He's appointing the same people in government. Yeah? So they are accomplices. The nationalists and the authoritarian regimes are effectively helping each other. Now, the opposition is not between them. It's not between the deep state, the deep establishment of the European Union, and the nationalist international. The opposition is between us and them. It is between Democrats, those who believe that democracy is not a luxury. It's not something that we like to have, but you know, you can only have it if you're rich. And if you're a creditor, if you're a debtor, you cannot begin to even aspire to democracy. We believe that democracy is a problematic system, but it is the best of all alternatives, as Winston Churchill used to say. And the lack of democracy in Brussels is giving rise to the policies that are destroying Europe and bringing about the nationalists who are reinforcing the inept authoritarianism of the establishment. So you're completely right. This was a very long-winded answer to your question, but I have to pay respect to the point that you're raising, which is that this is a very hard battle, because we have simultaneously to confront the inept authoritarian establishment and the nationalist international. It has to be a war at two fronts. We cannot fight just one, because if we just fight the nationalists, we are fighting against the symptoms, not the causes. If we fight against the establishment, we're fighting the causes, but not the symptoms. The symptoms are very painful. They have to be fought as well. So I'm afraid our task is difficult. There are no simple, easy solutions. There are colleagues of mine and former comrades of mine who say, oh, the solution is to let the European Union disintegrate and start from the beginning. That is silly. I have no love lost for the European Union or for the Brussels establishment and so on and so forth. But let's be honest about the reality we're facing. The disintegration of the current European Union is not going to favor us. It is not going to favor good people. It is not going to favor democracy. It is not going to favor humanism. The disintegration of the European Union, of this terrible European Union that we have, if tomorrow it dies, yeah, and everybody goes back to their nation states, it will be the Le Pens, the Alternative für Deutschland, the Golden Dawns that will benefit. They will come to power, and they are going to create circumstances that will be asphyxiating for Democrats, humanists, and Europeans in general.
Okay, thanks.
Marek Hrubec, thank you for your illuminating lecture. I share many points of what you explained. You said that the European Union was created as a cartel of some companies and so on. I agree, but I think that we should not idealize a national democratic system which was there in the past. I'm not sure if we really reached democracy. What we reach is a formal democracy, political democracy. But look, I can give you an example. Political parties and NGOs can be heavily deformed and corrupted by companies, by corporations. It's illegal in the Czech Republic and other states. The sponsor, so-called sponsor, I mean, corrupt political parties and to deform democracy. So what we have is probably oligarchy with democratic elements. In the past, it was a radical critique, but the last year, Princeton University published an analysis that the US is an oligarchic system and not a democratic anymore. And in many European countries, it's similar. Another example, in the Czech parliament, there is no left-wing political party which was created since 1989. No one, no single one, only many right-wing parties. We have only the left-wing parties which have the long tradition from the 19th century, Social Democratic Party, and from the 20s. The Communist Party. It's fine for some of us who like them, but many people would like to have also other parties. And I mean it from the systematic point of view. It's really strange that since the beginning of so-called democratic system, no left-wing party had a chance to enter the parliament. So I think that we should deal with this oligarchic problem. And I think that the problem on the European level is because the problem from the national level was reproduced and escalated on the European level. So I think that we have to talk not only about formal democracy, political democracy, but we have to talk about materialization of democracy, which means economic democracy as well. We need both aspects, economic democracy and political democracy. I cooperating now with people in Porto Alegre, in Brazil, when participatory budgeting and participatory system was created in 1989, and then local and global social fora. So they start from below, and people have a voice. They created, let's say, economic councils or gathering of civil society. There are many names of that, but it's economic democracy. It's just one aspect of economic democracy. There are many other kinds, but we should go from below with these, with the local people who decide about budgets of neighborhoods, cities, individual states, and so on. And this system spread to thousands of cities, not only Brazil, but Germany, France, and there are some attempts also here to make it. But there are other kinds of economic democracy, you know it. But I think that that's what we need to really to materialize the democracy, to have also economic and not only political democracy to achieve a better situation now. And then go from local level to national level and then the European level and, of course, the global level. I know it's complicated, but I just tried to sketch it and my time is limited. Anyway, thank you very much. And I'm very glad that you gave a lecture.
Well, look, you are entirely correct. Entirely correct. Not for one second would I claim that our nation states were ever democratic. What they do have is democratic process. There's a difference. As you said, take the United States. If you read the Federalist Papers that led to this Constitution of the United States, which is, the Constitution of the United States is a beautiful document. I wish we had one in Europe. But nevertheless, you're totally right. If you read the Federalist Papers, the concern of the so-called founding fathers of the United States Republic, federal democracy, their concern was how to keep people out of power. Their concern was how to make sure that the demos is not running the United States government. A representation was meant to replace democracy. not as part of democracy. The idea of representatives was to be representatives effectively of business, and to be to have a system of consulting the demos, the people, that so the whole point of representative democracy was to give an aura of democracy, but not the substance of democracy. So you're completely right. Nevertheless, even with this very imperfect democratic process in place, the purpose of which was to keep the majority out of power, I agree, and to make sure that economic democracy never happens, because that's what capitalism is. Capitalism is completely at odds with democracy. The whole point about capitalism is that capital rules economic life, and that capital is not subject to majority views. That's the whole point about capitalism. And as a left-winger, my critique of capitalism is not that it is unfair, but that it is inefficient. Because when you have a system where the majority do not control their economic choices and economic activities, then you end up with economic activities that are wasting resources and wasting whole generations to unemployment and so on. But nevertheless, there were moments when capitalism's crisis allowed brief periods during which the democratic process, which was there as a legitimizing mechanism for capitalism, was utilized in order to make, to bring in political processes and make and decisions that were good for the majority, and which went against some of the most toxic, sinister capitalist interests. Take, for instance, the New Deal in the United States, social democracy in Europe. These things happened against the wishes of the core of the capitalist class. And they happened because the democratic process which was in place allowed, during periods of crisis, systemic crisis, allowed the majority, the labor unions, the left, to infiltrate power for a while, not for a very long time. The juxtaposition, the contrast, is between that which happened at the level of the nation state and the European Union, which has absolutely no door that can be opened by the demos, by Europe's demos, to infiltrate the corridors of Brussels power. That's important. That is not an argument, as you say, and I agree completely with you. This is not an argument for eulogizing and legitimizing what the European Union does or what nation states do. It's just important to understand that these are the constraints we're facing. So democratization has to happen, as you say, at the level of the corporation, at the level of the business, of the corner store, of the city hall, of the local government budget creation process. At DiEM25, we're very, very honored to have as comrades people like Ada Colau and Jordi Ayala and Gerardo Pisarello, who are running the city of Barcelona. And we have worked with them towards creating an open budget process. You may have seen what we've done there together as part of our Rebel Cities Network, which we intend to spread throughout Europe, because it is at that level where economic democracy can be practiced, both at the level of cooperatives and the level of local government, before it infects the rest of the layers of government, all the way up to European Union level. So we are on the same page. We agree. It's a question of how do you take the experience from Porto Alegre, from the various cooperatives, and you make it relevant at a continental level, which is integrating by these experiments in cooperative, democratic, economic decision making.
Antonio Hoštica měl dotaz.
Hello.
Hi.
Hello. My name is Antoni Hoštica, and I would like to express big. I'm glad that we can meet you via this this connection, and many greetings from our DSC DM from South Bohemia. We are here also, several of us, and I have two questions. One, if you can, you wrote down one article left after the Brexit, and you describe several possible scenarios in case of policy of European Union will continue, that means so-called more democracy in their way of thinking. Second scenario is possibly Lexit, what will happen when we will allow, like via Lexit, disintegration of Europe. And third one, of course, is our DM approach. This is, can you explain a little bit deeper for our people here how you mentioned it? And second question is connected to the financial system of Europe. You mentioned that Greece was, say, Greek Spring was destroyed via banks, like before, via tanks. So, I mean, what to do with bank tanks? What kind of, proposal could be from your, according to your opinion. My idea, I am thinking now, and I am studying actually the situation of so-called ethical banks during the 2008. And it seems that this kind of banking or financing, which are most of them, which are in several countries, but a very low amount or very low quantity, it seems that are sustainable. There are so-called responsible financing. Isn't it one of the possible way how to transfer actual financing system to the one which should be useful for people? Thank you for your answer.
Right. Let's begin with Brexit, Lexit, exits, and so on and so forth. The point I was making in that article, and the point that I always try to convey to my friends in Britain, and I have lots of friends in Britain, on both sides of the argument, those in favor of Brexit and those against, my argument is really very simple. Folks, I say to them, you cannot get out. You can vote to get out. You can stop sending your ministers to Brussels and your prime minister to the European Union summit, but you're not out. Your economy and your society is so interwoven with the rest of Europe that you should stop thinking of Europe as a club. You know, the British have this notion, they think of everything in terms of clubs. With a club, there's a club there, and you ask yourself the question, do I want to be a member of this club? Yeah. Is it a good club? Do I want to pay my fee every month in order to be a member of this club? What is this club giving me? Is it good for me or is it bad for me? Do I want to be in it or not? Well, Europe is not a club. Europe is your ecology. It's your habitat. You don't have a choice. It's like me saying, I don't want to live on Earth. Well, tough. You know, I live on Earth. I can pretend that I'm not living on Earth. I can try to create a bubble like, you know, various crazy American actors who create a bubble and live in them. But nevertheless, I would still be in it. So, and moreover, it's a habitat, like our planet, that is fragmenting, that is best. Economics, the problems of investment, the problems of social security, the whole thing is fragmented, especially now with refugees and migration and all these waves of fear and loathing. So what I was saying to them is that, you know, you think that you can retreat from Europe and create your good democracy, your sovereign state in Britain on your own? Well, there are two reasons why you can't do that. Well, firstly, even if you do retreat, by retreating, you are accelerating the developments, the nasty developments in Europe. In Europe. Brexit is making the rest of Europe less sustainable. There are centrifugal forces now that are pulling Europe apart, which are now more powerful because the British left. And then there are, so at that point my British friends say, well, isn't that good that we left? Because, you know, it means that the whole thing is collapsing. We are abandoning a sinking ship. And the point I'm making is, no, you have not abandoned the sinking ship. You're still sinking in the same sinking ship, except you made the boat sink faster and you are going to drown on the same boat. So it's not really very clever. You cannot jump off that particular vessel. So since you cannot jump off, even by voting to get out, look at them now. They voted to get out. They're embroiled in an endless discussion about how to get out. And what does it mean to get out? They can't get out. So since you can't get out, why don't you stay in and fight with us in order to improve this place, to stop the ship from sinking? That's more or less the dim view about Brexit. Also one other point. By getting out, politics becomes more toxic. It does not become more democratic. It does not become more progressive. This is my argument against my Lexit friends, left-wing Brexit friends, who believed, Tariq Ali was one of them, they believed that Brexit would divide the right. It would divide the ruling class in favor of the working class. Yeah, right. The opposite happened. It's the left that is divided. It's the progressives who are divided. And it is the bigots and the xenophobes and the racists that are getting more united and stronger. So that's that question. The second question you asked about banking. Look, I believe that ethical banks, yes, okay, fine. I have a certain difficulty putting the word ethic with a bank next to one another. You know, it's, so what I would like is, I'll speak personally here. I would like to live in a world of weak, boring banks. Of banks that are a bit like the water company. You know, the water company provides you with water, it's very important, but it's not a huge corporation. It is not, doesn't rule everybody's lives. And this is not pie in the sky. It's not utopian. The Bretton Woods system that the Americans created, the New Dealers, Roosevelt's men, created in 1944, and which lasted up until 1971, was exactly such a system. In the 1950s and 1960s, bankers were weak. Bankers did not earn that much money. They were doing boring things. They were taking people's money and lending it. You know, now banks don't do that. They are creating all these newfangled, exotic instruments of debt out of thin air. So the answer, I think, to banking is to go back to the 50s and 60s in a modern environment, of course. They would be electronic, they would be internet-based, but they should be put back into their cage, the cage from which we should have public banks as well that are utilized in order to pursue public policy on investment. This idea that everything needs to be privatized has to be reversed. I don't mind having private banks, but I do mind having only private banks. Investment cannot be mobilized. Savings cannot be turned into investments in real, sustainable economic practices until and unless we have significant public investment banks.
Výborně. Vzadu byla otázka, prosím, jo, tady byla první, ano, potom vzadu.
Hello, Luigi Pavlíček. I would like to ask you about your, let's say, sentiment in the past. You mentioned that the main mistake of, let's say, Greece spring was that you hadn't any plan B. So my question is, so what you mean with this, and if it is still your idea, because now it seems me you are on the other way, because I would say that without big pressure, and means maybe revolutionary pressure to those, let's say, entities in Brussels and in Europe, we are not able to change anything, because what was mentioned here, this economic economic, let's say, equality is, let's say, important for any changes. And I cannot believe that some big monopolies or companies would like change something and voluntarily they would do some steps towards to this aim. So my question is, what this Plan B mean?
Well, thank you. Let me just clarify one thing. I had a Plan B and I had a Plan C and a Plan D and a Plan X. When I resigned, after I resigned my position, and I resigned because Prime Minister Tsipras refused to activate the plans we had when they closed down our banks. When I resigned, for about 2 weeks, the systemic media were criticizing me for having gone to enter the negotiations without a Plan B. Yeah, they were saying, oh, what an idiot. He went in there hoping he would convince them on the basis of rational arguments, and he didn't have a Plan B if they closed down the banks. I let them for 2 weeks say that. And then after that, I leaked that I did have a Plan B. And then they criticized me for having a Plan B. So you know, you just can't win with these people, right? With the systemic media. First they say he didn't have a Plan B, then oh, he had a Plan B. So both, whether you have a Plan B or not, in the eyes of the establishment, you have to be condemned. And you have to be condemned only because you're opposing them. That's the real reason. But let me be more specific. My line consistently was and remains that as a Europeanist, as a progressive Europeanist, I shall never promote or propose disintegration. I would never go there to Brussels and say that, you know, folks, I want to get out of the euro. Or I want to get out of the European Union. I do not believe this is constructive. I don't believe there is any reason to do that. What I did believe in doing is what at Diem we are now explaining us, describing us, the strategy of constructive disobedience. Constructive disobedience. I insist on those two words. Constructive in the sense that you say, okay, we have the euro. It's a terribly designed system. We have the European Union. It's not working very well. Here are my proposals. Here is what we can do tomorrow morning. Tomorrow morning. Not in 10 years' time or 30 years' time. I'm not asking for the moon. I'm not asking that we have a new treaty, federation, whatever. But these are things we can do to if we had proposals, modest proposals, realistic proposals, things we could have done immediately, improving the lives of millions of people, not just in Greece, but outside of Greece too. So that was a constructive part. And then the disobedience comes in when they say to you, no, we're not even discussing these proposals of yours. You will do as you're told. At that point, my line was, I'm not going to do what you're telling me to do. I'm just not going to sign on anything that you give me, that you're imposing upon me, which is far worse than what I'm proposing to you, especially when you're refusing to discuss my proposals. Convince me that my proposals are wrong. Explain to me why they're wrong, if they're wrong. But don't tell me that you're not going to look at my proposals and that I have to be obliged to do that which you are instructing me to do. So, constructive disobedience. That is the DiEM25 line for Europe. It was what I practiced in the ministry. And of course, then people rightly ask me, so what if they threw you out of the euro? What if they shut your banks down? Well, when I entered government, I had already agreed with the Prime Minister a deterrence plan, what we should have done to stop the European Central Bank from shutting our banks down. And that involved primarily two things. Firstly, to signal to Mario Draghi and the European Central Bank that if he dares shut down our banks, as he did, we would immediately unilaterally haircut 27 billion of a debt of bonds that the ECB owned. And that would have been a major blow at the European Central Bank, not because of the money was a lot, but it would be a legal problem for them because then they would have to justify why they were buying everybody else's bonds if the bonds could be haircut. And the second signal that we should have sent and which I was working towards was a parallel payment system, a payment system that could function with other banks in order to make sure that for 1, 2, 3 weeks, our economy could continue to be run, not brilliantly, but be run. Transactions could be made, people could buy and sell stuff and make exchanges, even with the banks closed. Because that would have bought us these 2, 3 weeks, which would be fantastically important, because those 2, 3 weeks would have made the European Central Bank and Mrs. Merkel come back to us with a decent proposal. And even if they didn't, and the Wolfgang Schäuble line prevailed of getting rid of Greece from the Eurozone, fine. We had another plan, we called it Plan X, for going to the national currency. So this is the policy of constructive disobedience. And this is a policy which DiEM25 recommends for every member state of the European Union. Remember, this is not a policy of confrontation. This is a policy of reason, of rationality, of moderation. What you say is, let's sit down and have a proper discussion on how to change the policies that are now destroying Europe. How to
zásah Evropské komise, že by? A vidíme ho? No, podívej se tam na něj, podívej se ještě online. Na něj, jako zeď. Tak Janis Varoufakis se odpojil, ale zkusíme počkat, jestli se ještě nepřipojí. Tady. Dobrá. Tak dáme 5 minut, jestli se náhodou Janis Varoufakis nepřipojí. Pokud ne, tak bychom pokračovali normálně v programu konference, abychom se nezdržovali a mohli tady pokračovat v debatě. Hi Janis, welcome back.
I'm back.
Okay, super. Okay.
So did you hear the last words I said about constructive disobedience, or was I disconnected before?
Constructive disobedience was heard, yes.
Okay, good.
Great. So I would ask for next question.
Hello, my name is Tina. Kalimera, Stina, Tina.
Kalimera.
You partly answered a question I'd like to ask, but let me ask this way: what about the political economics behind the alternatives? Speaking the European level, yeah. What about the EMU? You have mentioned it partly. What has become of it? What should have become of it? Is that a good euro alternative? People like Costa, Lapavitsas, and others have spoken about it. There's no alternative. Well, it's an attitude. Do you agree that in order to be a viable EMU of any use for some economic democratic alternative, to be viable, to be sustainable, there should be a possible transfer union at the European level. So that's what interests me. Mm-hmm. You know, the political economics behind behind the alternative, possible alternative.
Mm-hmm. For years now, together with other economists, we have been working on designing a mechanism by which the euro could become sustainable and consistent with shared prosperity. Because the problem with the euro, as you know, and as Kostas Lapavitsas and others know, is that the way it is constructed today, it is not consistent with shared prosperity. What happens is you have periods of Ponzi growth, of unsustainable growth, that are fueled by loans effective from Germany, and then you have periods of collapse of the periphery where the periphery is squashed, it is squeezed, it is suppressed by huge austerity that is destroying whole generations in countries like Spain and so on and so forth, while also infecting badly the working class of places like Germany. So we've worked on proposals on how to stabilize the euro, how to create a simulation of a federation without a federation, of how to have the transfer union. Let me just give you a very brief example. Instead, imagine that there was a huge, very large, New Deal-like investment-led recovery program for Europe, where 5% of total income, total European income, is being invested every year by the European Investment Bank. And the European Investment Bank doesn't get this from taxes, but it gets this from borrowing, from issuing its own bonds. And the European Central Bank is sitting next to it, standing next to it, ready to buy these bonds in the money markets in order to support it. Now that is a transfer union without having a federation. We could do this tomorrow morning. You don't even need a new treaty of the European Union to do this. Okay, this is the constructive part of our constructive disobedience. These are proposals that are moderate. You can do them tomorrow. It will be a European New Deal. And if you do them, then the euro becomes sustainable. We don't need to break it up. So this is a constructive part, right? Now, where people like Lapavitsas are correct, and I experienced that, and I know it is better than anyone, is when you go to Europe, to Brussels, and you propose this, they say no. That's where the disobedience part comes. And my line there was, well, if you don't agree to something like that, I'm not going to agree to what you're suggesting. So we're going to have a clash. And we're going to have a clash between the reasonable, moderate proposals that we're putting forward and your irrational, authoritarian ones. And the responsibility for this clash is yours, not ours. The responsibility goes with the irrational. It does not go with the rational and modest. Okay? The difference I have with the Plan B people, like Lapavitsas, Mélenchon, Oscar Lafontaine, is that they are saying, oh, the euro cannot work, the European Union as it stands cannot work, so let's disintegrate it. So they turn the disintegration of the euro into their objective. I disagree profoundly with this, because that puts you on the same side as Le Pen. Because it puts you on the same side with those who are arguing for a disintegration that will be immensely costly for the whole of Europe. So notice the subtle but important difference. The Lapavitsas, Mélenchon, Lafontaine Plan D line is, let's go for disintegration. It's our aim. Let's go back to our national currencies. Yeah? What we're saying at the end is something different, but related. What we're saying is, we do not propose disintegration. I am not proposing that we disband the euro. We are proposing these very moderate, simple, rational policies that would fix the euro. But I do not fear the end of the euro. I am not going to be scared into submission if you threaten me with an exit from the euro. So I'm not proposing national currencies, but I do not fear them. This is the whole point about constructive disobedience, a big difference of opinion with people like Lapavitsas. I think that this Lexit idea, the idea of a left-wing exit from the European Union as an objective, is a major gift to the nationalists. One we should not give them.
Hi, I'm Mikuláš Peksa, and I would like to ask you a bit more about the story you previously discussed. I guess neither Wolfgang Schäuble nor your prime minister were stupid guys, and obviously there had to be some plan B, X or Y or whatever from German or Schäuble's side, and also there had to be a real reason for your prime minister to give up and to submit to their demands. So my question is more or less, how could you describe in your words what happened in that time? What was Tsipras so much scared that he decided to do it that way that he did?
I'm happy to talk to you about Schäuble, less happy to talk to you about Tsipras. Because Schäuble had a very clear plan. And he, from his perspective, it was logical. I disagree with it. But it was clear what he wanted to do. Schäuble has this view that the Eurozone is too large and that it should shrink. It should get rid of the deficit Mediterranean countries, not just Greece. Greece is the first one. And turn the Eurozone into a surplus country, hard currency zone. Whether France is in it or not is something I don't think that Schäuble has decided yet. But certainly Greece, Portugal, Spain, probably Italy needs to get out as far as Schäuble is concerned. So what Schäuble wanted to do was Grexit. He wanted to push us out. The great problem that he had was not me. It was not the Greeks. It was somebody called Angela Merkel, who disagreed with him. So you see, one of the terrible difficulties in negotiating with Germany was I didn't know who to negotiate with. Because if you agreed with Schäuble, Merkel disagreed, and if you agreed with Merkel, Schäuble disagreed. So, you know, this is something that you've got to take very seriously into consideration. Now, regarding Tsipras, allow me just for one brief moment to give him the benefit of the doubt. Brief moment, then I will take it back. But briefly, let me give him the benefit of the doubt. There is no doubt that the prime minister of a small bankrupt country that is being squeezed and asphyxiated by the central bank, by the International Monetary Fund, by Chancellor Merkel, by France, by Italy, is in a very difficult position. I acknowledge that. It was not an easy position to be in. The banks had been closed. Washington was not helping. Russia was not helping. No one was helping. We were being squeezed. So I understand that. But then again, didn't we know this before we got in? What did we think we were doing? We knew perfectly well. We were not naive. Those who want, you know, the prime minister himself, Tsipras himself, has actually tried to explain his capitulation, his surrender, by saying, oh, we were naive. We were not that naive. For 2 years before we got into government, I was having these conversations with him. In 2013, I had a very long conversation with him in which I said to him, look, watch what's happening in Cyprus. Remember 2013, the Troika and the ECB closed down the Cyprus banks. And I said, what's happening in Cyprus? Is what's going to happen to you when you become prime minister? This is a dress rehearsal of what they're going to do to you. At the time, I didn't have any inkling that I would be his finance minister, right? So I was advising him as a friend, primarily, saying, this is, they are trying this out. It's a dress rehearsal so that they are ready to squash you, to asphyxiate you when you get elected, or somebody like you in Spain, Portugal, wherever. We had discussed time and again, before we got in, that the only reason for getting in was to resist this capitulation the moment they closed down the banks. Firstly, how to stop them from closing down the banks. And secondly, if they do close down the banks, what do we do then? When he agreed with me on these two issues, two questions, how do you stop them from closing down our banks? And secondly, how do we respond in defense of our government if they close down the banks? When we agreed on that, which was in November 2014, before we got into government, 3 months before we got into government almost. That's when I decided to go into the government to help. We had a plan. We had an agreement. It was the only reason for getting into government, that plan, that agreement. We knew we were going into a very bloody battle. And the only reason for getting in was a determination not to surrender. But he surrendered. And he surrendered in ways that effectively, allow me to, I'm not going to say much about that, but I will put it in an impressionistic way. From March, April onwards, I felt that he was sending me to the battlefield, but my small weapon, I had one small weapon, the one we had agreed that I should carry with me, the bullets had been taken out by our own side. And the moment the other side understood that, we didn't have the deterrence that we had agreed we should have. So it's not just that he surrendered on the 6th of July. It was a process of effectively undermining those of us who went in to do battle. And the surrender was inevitable. So, there. And it's not a question of intelligence. It's a question of priorities. And it's a question of, if you want, the moral makeup of the people involved.
Thank you, Yanis. I have one written question from the audience for you, so I will try to translate it. The question is, what is your strategy for unifying such different currents, such as Marxist, Greens, feminist, Democrats of all kinds? So how would you like to do it?
Oh, very, very good question. If you read the manifesto, that the strategy, the ideological strategy, is in there. The Manifesto of Diem is, I think, we are quite proud of that document because it is a genuine manifesto in the sense that it sets down the ideological common ground upon which we can build this alliance. What we have in common as Marxists, liberals, feminists, what do we have in common? What we have in common is that we live in a Europe which is making it impossible for freedom to prevail. Freedom is being used as a slogan in order to restrict it. It is impossible to be a woman these days without suffering increasing patriarchal authority. What we are seeing everywhere now is because of this depression and the centrifugal forces, suddenly sexism is exciting again. Think of Donald Trump, think of Nigel Farage in Britain, think of Fillon in France. The social conservatism in your country, in Hungary, in Poland, it is impossible these days to simply take it for granted that a young person who happens to be female is going to have tomorrow a better life than her mother's or grandmother's head as an autonomous, free person capable of running her own body and life. What does the feminist and the liberal have in common with the Marxist? Well, wage labor is being squashed. Wage labor is being cheapened. The quality of jobs is diminishing very, very fast, and so on and so forth. So, if in other words, we are facing a common enemy. It's one of these rare opportunities to bring together the narratives of liberty, of identity, of openness, of sustainability with the Greens, and bring it into one common framework. Which is doing what? It is putting forward an economic agenda for Europe that reverses these losses for all of us, for all the categories that I mentioned. We call this the European New Deal. It is an economic agenda that we've been working very hard on. I invite you all to participate through DiEM25's site in the construction, the creation of this policy paper, which we entitled the European Green New Deal. That paper is going to be completed in February and presented in Paris on the 23rd, 24th, and 25th of February. And we trust and hope that it is an economic agenda that creates room and hope for liberals, feminists, greens, Marxists, progressive conservatives even.
Thank you. Last question.
Okay.
A slightly related question. Here in the Czech Republic, we have a lot of people in the center, maybe the center left, who are very keen to fight the, what you call the Nationalist International. They're less keen to fight the inept authoritarians. In fact, they're very scared of fighting the inept authoritarians because they see any criticism of Brussels as something to be very afraid of because it's going to weaken the European Union. In fact, they accuse us on the left, they accuse of siding with the Nationalist Internationals because, let's face it, they see this as a geopolitical question. They see the European Union, they do see it as a club. They see it as something that, a club of which we can be, from which we can be snatched away and taken to some other habitat. So what would you say to them to help persuade them that we can be critical of Brussels?
Well, thank you. It's the story of my life. It's what I experience on a daily basis. And this is what I'm being accused of being anti-European. And my standard response to this question is this. As a patriot, I spent most of my life criticizing my government. Czechs understand that, especially those who lived under a terrible regime prior to 1991, right? As patriots, you opposed the state. You did not oppose the state of Czechoslovakia or the Czech Republic later as anti-Czechs. It was because you were patriots that you opposed your government. And, you know, this is a standard line of any liberal, that we have an obligation as patriots to oppose our government when our government is wrong. As Europeanists, we have an obligation to oppose Brussels when Brussels is wrong. Because when Brussels is wrong, it is making policies, it is implementing policies that are bad for Europe. So if you really want to oppose the Nationalist International, you have to attack the causes of the strength of the Nationalist International. And what are the causes of the strength of the Nationalist International? This comedy of errors, which is happening in Brussels. Every time they meet in the European Union summit, they make a mistake. It's a sequence of mistakes that would have been comical if they were not so tragic. They are disintegrating the European Union. They are creating the circumstances for the disintegration of the European Union, which lead to the rise of the Nationalist International. So just like a patriotic British person has to criticize the British government, a Greek person, the Greek government, a Czech patriot, the Czech government, we who believe in Europe, who want a united Europe, who do not want to be snatched away from Europe, who do not want to see the collapse of Europe that would lead us being snatched away by Putin or by whomever. We need to criticize Brussels for Europe's sake. I think that, yeah, that's my answer, at least.
Okay, Yanis, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for your answers, for being with us. I think the audience would like to thank you as well.
And I want to thank everyone. Well, join DiEM25, folks.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.